and the door will open. Seek and you will find. Ask and you'll be given the key to this world of mine. I'll be waiting here with my arms unfurled, waiting just for you. Welcome to my world.
The man widely proclaimed as the father of modern-day Nevis, the Right Honourable Dr. Simeon Daniel, passed away on Sunday, May 27th. In the coming days, we'll be speaking to a number of Nevisians whose life he impacted. And today, our special guest is the Venerable Spencer Howell, who has been a very close friend of the late Nevisian leader. Spencer, how long have you known Dr. Simeon Daniel?
I have known, and pardon if I refer to him as Sim, because, you know, because of our associations, I still think of him as Sim. I've known Sim back in the early 50s. I knew him more specifically when he lived in Charlestown at the Charlestown Anglican Church Rectory. And I visited the rectory oft times because as a member of the Anglican Church Choir and that sort of thing, we met and had games and so on up there. So we spent some time together there.
Would you remember who was at the rectory at that time, which Anglican minister?
Yes, there was an Anglican minister, an Englishman, Thomas, Father Thomas. Everybody knew him as Father Thomas, W.A. Thomas. And he, in fact, lived in Nevis. He was maybe one of the oldest resident Anglican priests here. He lived in Nevis for 25 years. He went back to England. And in fact, I did visit him up in England myself. But he was making plans to come back to live on Nevis his final days. Unfortunately, in the planning stages, he just did not make it.
Now, Sim was born in the rural village of Barnesgut.
Yes.
Was this an adoption of thought, or was this a youngster who the good minister saw had some good in him and wanted to nurture him, so to speak?
I think it's more a nurturing situation, because he was a school teacher, and you know, I think there were more chances of his getting and going forward within the Charlestown environment then.
Certainly, it's the country boy,
yes.
The boy from Barnesgut coming into to the capital.
Yes.
Because in the 1950s there would have been very few opportunities for youngsters growing up in Barnesgut. What was he like then, though?
He was very quiet and unassuming. We played things like ping pong and so on together, table tennis. But and he would sit and chat, but he was not a very loud and outspoken person. He was always very quiet. And
did he show any leadership qualities then?
I can't say he did.
At what point did he decide that he wanted to study law, and who were the people who encouraged him to do that?
He went off to England in the early 50s, as I said, and I don't know. I think myself that his leaning was more towards the ministry.
Mm-hmm.
And we thought at one time that he might become an Anglican priest. And he went off to England, and I don't know what changed in his life, because then we were not really in close touch.
Mm-hmm.
The next thing we heard that he was doing law.
Was it the Anglican minister, who I gathered was English, taking him back to the homeland, or was it like so many other Nevisians in the 1950s where the fathers sold cotton, sold the animals to get the son off to England so that he could bring a better life to the whole family?
I am not speaking with any certainty, but I get the impression that that would have been more the situation where the family sent off a son to to help to better the conditions.
And Sim came back to Nevis when? About what time?
He came back to Nevis in the 60s. I'm going to say around 1966. Stand subject to correction. But he came back and he, having qualified as a lawyer, he came back and he was given a job with the government of the country at the time.
The government of St. Kitts.
Of St. Kitts Nevis. Because Sim's father was a great ally of the late Robert Bradshaw.
Okay.
And he, in fact, he was the, I'm going to use this term, he was the point man for labor in Nevis. He, in fact, was the treasurer, and he collected the dues of the people who were labor, members of the Labor Party. And I get the impression that he did get some assistance from Mr. Bradshaw to encourage him to come back and with the promise of a job and everything else. And he did get a job with government right after he came back.
What sort of person was his father?
His father, Job Daniel, everybody knew in that area knew Job Daniel. He was a very outspoken man. He was a very outspoken man. And I go back to say that everybody referred to him as Mr. Labour in Nevis.
So do you think it was a father, on reflection, who nurtured the politician in him, or do you think that the leader then, Robert Bradshaw, had designs on Sim Daniel as a future leader?
That's a loaded question. That's a loaded question, but I, as a young man with a young family and all that sort of thing coming back, he had to, I think usually the first thing you're looking for a job and for some security. That's where it all started. But gradually, I think with his legal training, he saw an opening. He saw an opening, and it was at the time when there was this St. Kitts Nevis thing going. And so there was this split in Nevis as to whether we're going to stay with St. Kitts or we're going to secede. In fact, the first time I ever heard the word secession was round about that time.
Well, remember in April 1961, just reading The Legacy of Dr. Simeon Daniel on the weekend, the late Eugene Walwyn did lead a march in April of 1961 onto Grove Park, now the El Camino Chinito Willard Park, in a quest for Nevis to secede.
For secession, that's correct. And that was followed up by a march to St. Kitts. Not many months after, to Government House in St. Kitts.
And so he...
And I don't think that Sim was actually back in Nevis at that time.
I don't think he was. Yeah.
I don't think he was. But he came back and the two leading political figures at the time in Nevis, as I recall, were Eugene Walwyn and Ivor Stevens. And then they were on different sides of the coin.
So, UNM and PAM?
UNM, and I'm not so sure whether it was UNM and PAM, but I know they were
on opposing sides. So how did Sim get into it? You said that you were close friends before he left. He must have reconnected with you, to you, when you got back to Nevis. When was that torch lit in him to become the political firebrand that he became?
Well, I'm going to tell you something. Sim and I hardly ever spoke politics. He was my friend. We would go out for lunch, we'd go out for dinner, and we would always meet someplace for a drink. But we rarely ever spoke politics, because I tried to shy away from that subject. But when that spark was lit in him, I can't say. And I'm sure there are people like Ural Swanston and Ron Leibert and people of that ilk who would be better able to say how this phase of his life came about.
Well, I've done some research, and of course there was that very short man from Gingerland, R.J. Gordon, and then people like Walwyn and Rooks and Nichols and so on.
Yeah.
Do you know if he read voraciously about past leaders on Nevis? Did he study the history of Nevis from a political standpoint?
I don't know. I don't know.
So was it a surprise for you, for instance, in 1970, October, I think, of 1970, when the Nevis Reformation Party was born? Because after all, you said his father, Joe, was a point man for Labour and Nevis.
Yes.
And here was the birth of a new party, the Nevis Reformation Party, which in its philosophy was as far away
as very opposed to
To the Labour Party. Did that shock you?
And there were some surprises, yes. There were some surprises as to. And we waited with bated breath to see what's going to come out of this. Because even within and up to this day, they're always the two sides of Nevis. I mean, two points of view, rather. So whether we should secede or whether we should stay on. And I think that all of that was fueled more in 1967, when there was the Anguilla Revolution. And from the Anguilla Revolution, then things really started to heat up.
And of course, the August 1st, 1970, sinking of the Christina. It is months after that that birth was given to the NRP, because so many Nevisians, including myself, who lost an uncle and a cousin, felt that we were done in by the powers that be across the waters. So we had the NRP in 1970. Look back now at the years that he led Nevis, the dream of secession not yet fulfilled, and I don't know if you've had recent conversations with him. What are his feelings? What were his feelings as regards the political status of Nevis?
I think at heart he was a secessionist. He wanted secession, but I rather got the impression that he was not getting the fullest support from his party. That is my impression. Like I say, I always steered shy of the of any political discussions. But
Let's speak then to some of the things which he put his stamp on Nevis. As I said at the introduction, there's no doubt about it that he's the father of modern-day Nevis.
He is, yes.
1980, the first sixth form college in Nevis. What did that mean to the youngsters on Nevis?
Well, it must have meant a great deal, because prior to this, I mean, you only had 3, 4, 5 students who were able to go off to St. Kitts to go to college. See, by this time, of course, I was a civil servant, I was working, I had my stint, because when I left school, my first job was over in St. Kitts. And as they say, it ain't easy working over there, working and living there. Sufficient to say, however, that whatever I am today, I owe a great deal of it to St. Kitts, because I was thrown out there on my own, and you had to fight for yourself. And I think...
Helped with your independence?
That helped me with my independence.
1983. That must have shocked everybody, because he moved from a position, it was secession at all costs, to form a coalition with Dr. Kennedy Simmons and his People's Action Movement.
Yeah.
Which, of course, led to the 1983 Constitution, which gave Nevis its own island assembly after 101 years, 1882.
Yeah.
What did that mean for Nevisians?
Well, you know, I still think that the Nevisian political community is divided. Because, you know, there was this secession at all costs, and then all of a sudden there were people who were saying, well, look, man, we could get on otherwise. And we, okay, here was the opportunity in 83 when we became, first of all, the occasion came in 1980 when at that coalition government, when that coalition government was formed. I still feel that Nevis could have bargained harder at that point in time, because the PAM party wanted government at all costs, and I get the impression that they were prepared to give the Nevisian side of the party whatever it wanted. Of course, Mr. Daniel got maybe one of the best positions, Minister of Finance. But I don't think that he did the best possible job. He's my friend, and I've told him this several times. He more or less abdicated his position and let a junior minister for a long time run the Ministry of Finance.
Couldn't it be said in his defense, though, that he was fighting for the Nevisian cause, that as Minister of Finance in St. Kitts, the expectation is that you would look after St. Kitts, maybe even more so than Nevis, because that had been the tradition. This was a change of mindset here. And so he used that time to put a number of things in place for Nevis. I could remember when we all went to the airport, for instance, sometime in 1980, because the airport got lit for the first time. The MV Carib Queen came in to improve transportation between the islands. The Nevis sixth form was put in place. He was making strides towards putting the first civil service in place in Nevis. And of course, he bargained to ensure that there was Section 113 in the Constitution to safeguard Nevis.
Yeah.
What harder bargain do you think he could have struck?
He did accomplish a whole lot. But to me, in this game, you've got to go for the whole hog. And I think, for instance, that Mr. Ivor Stevens, he was also a minister in that coalition government. And from what I could recall, I mean, Ivor got whatever he wanted for...
Well, he was an unconventional man.
He was unconventional.
So he's told of the day that he transported a truck from St. Kitts to Nevis for the Public Works Department, and there was a bit of a backlash. Dr. Simeon Daniel was of a different ilk.
Yes, he was.
He was a negotiator. What do you think? What else could he have done, you think?
It's hard to say what else he could have done, but I feel it was a matter of bargaining. I am not going to be able to say right off, well, he could have got this, that, or the other, but and he did get a lot of things done. I think what happened afterwards in 1983 was maybe much more important, because in 83 This was the independence, and with independence came a number of things.
Did you get a sense that the element of trust was not there, though? Because I'm thinking, as you speak, about him not getting enough, about the backdrop against which he operated. In 1984, the very first opportunity after independence, Dr. Kennedy Simmons and his People's Action Movement gerrymandered the boundaries in St. Kitts so that there were now 8 seats in St. Kitts. The PAM won 6, and then there were, I think, 3 seats in Nevis. Mm-hmm. 1 seat was added in Nevis. And lo and behold, the Kennedy Simmons administration had no more love for Dr. Simeon Daniel. He was made Minister of the Environment, if you remember
yes,
that.
Yes, uh-huh.
So could it be that there was not the culture of trust, because there had been so much distrust between these islands for so many years?
I would go along with you and agree with that. There was some mistrust, a lot of mistrust.
Now let's fast forward to 1985. A big dream of his, the Bank of Nevis.
Like I said, we met regularly. We always went someplace for a drink or for lunch or something. And he mooted this idea of the Bank of Nevis. And I was asked to buy some shares and so on, which I did, and the Bank of Nevis came into being. It was at a time when the realization was that here is an opportunity for us to get our own bank. There was a Bank of the Nevis Cooperative Bank before, but that had its shortcomings, and that was losing its grip on its people. And I think that the formation of the Bank of Nevis was at an opportune time, because then Nevis had a growth. However small, it had a growth. You had a lot of visitors come into the island, settling and buying property and getting involved in businesses and so on. And they were able to use the services of the Bank of Nevis. And as is now history, the Bank of Nevis has grown from strength to strength to strength. I mean, it's way up there.
Improving the quality of life.
Improving the quality of life.
Do you think he saw these as building blocks along the way towards an independent Nevis, the sixth form, land reform, etc.? Did you see them as building blocks towards an independent Nevis?
Well, he was very up on education, and the sixth form college was really one of his dreams. And as I said, the whole idea of once you reached that stage and you wanted to go for further education, you had to go over to St. Kitts, and with all its problems, a lot of people didn't end up going. He further went on with in the education policy to be tied up with a university in Florida,
the Miami-Dade.
Yes, and so on, and that.
Respectively, 17 and 21. Students benefited from that.
Yes. Uh-huh. So
now, after he left active politics, I believe to a lot of people's disappointment, he sort of melted away from society. 1992, his party lost the election. Very shortly after, our first deputy governor general, Mr. Weston Parris, passed away.
Yes.
He moved away from society, so to speak. Did that disappoint you?
Yes, and in fact, I think I used that opportunity from time to time to draw him out, to get him out of the doldrums, and maybe this was one of the ways. We always went someplace and for lunch or something.
Do you think that was because of disappointment, disillusionment with the way things had gone, the fact that in his time as a political leader he did not achieve his ultimate goal?
I would say that he became very disappointed. He was very disappointed when he lost, because his mantra was that, look, I have done so much for the people of Nevis. He could not see himself as losing, and he became very disillusioned when he, in fact, did lose.
Mm-hmm. Tell us a bit about the man. Now that his eyes are closed, he's gone. We know what happens normally in Nevisian and West Indian society. We're going to hear the glowing tributes and all of that. But you knew him up front and close.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about the man, Simeon Daniel.
What can I say about Sim? We met. There are certain places. For instance, we had a mutual friend in Irvin Brantley, and we would meet at Irvin's house on a regular basis to play dominoes. And as I said, I mean, after all, we were drinking people, and we would always have a drink. And we would talk. But I think he got to the stage when, I never encouraged it, of course, but he would not want to talk about politics at all. He talked about development and hope for seeing projects come to Nevis. And he worked on that, even out of government. I think he built up a good relationship in his legal office when he was more active in his legal office. And so I would say that he was disappointed. He was disappointed and disillusioned and several other words you could use. And he started to retire from society.
Became reclusive.
He became reclusive.
Mm-hmm. What's going to be his lasting legacy?
In my mind, his legacy is what he was able to accomplish for the island of Nevis. Without a doubt, he's the one who brought the Four Seasons to Nevis in his time. He's the one who brought, maybe more importantly, the Bank of Nevis. And as long as the Bank of Nevis lasts, I think his name would be written there somewhere. Always. To me, those were the greater part of his legacy.
I'm Nevisian, but I've always felt that Nevis is probably the most unappreciative country in the world. He's been out of politics for 20 years this year, mm-hmm. retiring in 1992.
Mm-hmm.
And in so many other Caribbean countries, there are monuments to the achievements of our leaders.
Mm-hmm.
There can be no doubt that he has been, or has to his credit, more achievements than anyone else.
Very
but
true.
But yet, there's nothing that bears his name.
Mm-hmm.
Should Nevisians not feel guilty for this?
Nevisians should feel guilty. Nevisians should feel guilty. However, you know, somewhere along the line, the Nevisian community was not particularly, in my mind, was not particularly looking for something bearing his name. The Nevisian community, or a lot of people that I spoke with, saw him as being knighted, which is the highest rank that one gets up in this life, Sir somebody or the other, Sir Simeon. That position was not something that the Nevisian community could have endowed on him. This had to be coming from the higher ups, from all the way up in London. It seems to me that none of the parties because he was there. I suppose while you're in office, it's not easy to say, well, look, give me my knighthood now. But when once he came out, got out of office, the next 14 years that the CCM was in government, I don't get the impression that he was ever recommended for such a position. Then in comes his party again, NRP. I don't get the impression that he was ever recommended either. But there was always the saying, I've always heard this, and I asked him and he never gave me an answer directly, because the impression that I got was that he said he did not want any knighthood, he didn't want them to recommend him for anything. Now, I don't know how true this is, but this was said over and over again. And so he has gone to the great beyond without having some accolade attached to his name. It's interesting, however, that when the new NIPAC is called?
NIPAC, the Performing Arts Center.
Performing Arts Center was being opened, Minister Premier Parry, he actually referred to something which, through my interpretation, says that, look, we don't have to ask Mr. Daniel to have this place named after him. We can name it after him. He can't do anything about it when once it's named after him. And I am hoping, and I get the distinct impression that the Performing Arts Center would certainly one day bear the name of Dr. Simeon Daniel.
That you think would be a fitting tribute?
That is a fitting tribute. That is a great tribute. A monument like that is going to be there for a long, long time.
Yes.
And I think that is, in a way, maybe even more fitting than to be called Sir Simeon.
Well, you know, I differ with you in knighthoods, because I believe that once a country becomes independent, it must put away all vestiges of colonialism. Mm-hmm. So I'm never pleased to hear anybody in my country being knighted. I think that we have to recast our society in our own image, mm-hmm. and find ways to honor our own people. Now, here in the Federation, we've got at least two things named by sitting leaders. Mm-hmm. On St. Kitts, you've got the Kennedy-Simmons Highway, mm-hmm. named while he was in office.
While he was in office.
And the Vance W. Amory Airport, named while he was the Premier of Nevis.
Yeah.
The late Premier never brought glory to himself. He was such a simple man. Never sought glory, even in his last days when people sought to laud him.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that is to his credit? That he did what he did for the benefit of his people?
I think that's to his credit.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's to his credit. That's the way, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he, and that's the way he felt. He was not looking for the plaudits.
Mm-hmm.
He was doing what he felt was for the country.
Now, the Premier returns to the country, I understand, this evening, and of course, over the next couple of days, we, as a country, will roll out a program for his burial. What would you like to see, though?
Well, as is traditional, I am expecting that there would be a state funeral. And with a state funeral comes all the trimmings of the bands and the troops marching. I mean, this is your last grand hurrah. I don't know what else to expect. I mean, a funeral is a funeral is a funeral. But those trappings, I would certainly like to see that they are there, if I had anything to do with it.
Finally, in one word, who was Sim Daniel? One word.
A great leader.
One word.
I am trying to think how I could...
Thought you'd say patriot.
Patriot. That's a very good word. That is maybe the best word that I could think of. I wasn't even thinking of it, but now you brought it to the forefront. In one word, Sim Daniel, a patriot.
Thank you, Spencer, for sharing some thoughts on a Nevisian patriot, the late Dr. Simeon Daniel. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And the door will open. Seek and you will find. Ask and you'll be given the key to this world of mine. I'll be waiting here with my arms unfurled, waiting just for you. Welcome to my world.